Great morning, my dear friends. Bhupesh Anand this side. So today we will be starting with lecture number 2, and the name of the reading is Monetary and Fiscal Policy. We have discussed first lecture. I have delivered a first lecture in Monetary and Fiscal Policy. Within that, I just told you what is the meaning of, you know, monetary policy and fiscal policy. So today we will be starting with lecture number 2. Please take out your registers. I have written a quotation for the class. Without self-discipline, success is impossible. A very important quotation, you know. It is the self-discipline which only helps us in getting, fulfilling our dreams, in getting the success. So the first step for success is having self-discipline. And as your papers are approaching, so you have to be self-disciplined in this. So my dear friends, lecture number 2, very important reading named as Monetary and Fiscal Policy. So I will be giving 5 stars to this reading, and today we will be doing with learning outcome number B, the most important learning outcome. That what is the meaning of a money? Why money is important, or what are the types or definitions of money? So please take out your registers. Learning outcome number 2, describe functions. What is a function and definitions of money? So we'll be talking of money. Describe functions and definitions of money. I will be dealing with money, my dear friends, 2000 notes. I will be dealing with money, and when I say money, what are the functions of this money? What are the functions of this money? How to deal with this money? Why it is more important, you know, why it is an added advantage as compared to barter system. So I'm talking of Indian rupees. These Indian rupees are in my hand, and in this Indian rupee, it is given, or in any rupee it is given, I promise to pay this much to the bearer of this person. So I will be talking of money. So describe the functions and the definitions of money. Now, with the help of this money, you know, with this currency note, I can purchase a cup of tea, I can have a pizza, I can have a shirt, I can purchase petrol, I can have vegetables, I can exchange it with any goods and services. So money is defined as a medium of exchange. Now, with the help of this money, I can exchange. It is a medium of exchange. I can give this money and I can buy something in against of that. As compared to barter system, you know, earlier in the ancient days, the prevalent system was barter system, and money was not there. When I say barter system, it means when one commodity is being exchanged, one goods are being exchanged in relation to another goods. For example, in a village, there are two communities, and one community is having oranges and another community is having apples. So if this community who is having apples wants to have orange, then they will give apples and they will buy oranges, and this community will give oranges and they will buy apples. It means it is a barter system. When I say barter, it means it is an exchange of goods and in against of goods. But today in this era, we are living in a money era, you know. When I say money, I talk of INR, I am talking of USD, GBP, Yen, Australian dollar, Italy lira, Chinese yuan. So I will be talking of money. So money is a medium of exchange. It is a better system as compared to barter. Because when I say barter, it has so many demerits. So please write in first point, money is defined as a medium of exchange rather than exchanging goods and services directly. I repeat, money is a system. Money is a medium of exchange rather than exchange of goods and services in a barter economy. Now, what I mean by barter economy? You all aware of barter economy, that if I want to buy a calculator, I can exchange this calculator with this with this Duracell. It means I am giving these cells and I am taking calculator. This is named as barter system. But now this barter system has so many drawbacks. The first drawback, I have written so many drawbacks. So please write on second point. Barter economy, it is exchange of goods with goods. It is exchange of goods with goods. It is exchange of goods with goods. I will exchange goods with goods. Following are the drawbacks of barter economy. So these are the drawbacks, you know. Because firstly, in any economy, you know, in the ancient days, in the Stone Age, and then after that, other age, in that era, there was a barter system which was prevalent, but it has so many drawbacks. The first drawback of that system was, it is, you know, double coincidence. I have written double coincidence of wants. Now, what is this double coincidence of want? For example, Mr. A is a manufacturer of aircraft and he wants to buy a milk from a milk vendor. Okay. Now the point is, if you are in the barter system, then how he will exchange will aircraft with half 1 liter of milk? Either he will be giving just air top, or he will be giving one wheel or some part of wheel. It means the point is, it may be possible that milk vendor who is selling the milk may not require that air top. So there is a clash of coincidence of the wants. So first drawback is double coincidence of wants. It may be possible, but rarely it is, generally it is not possible, that if I want to buy that good and that person also wants to buy the same good which I am possessing. So that is named as double coincidence of wants. Generally it does not happen. So this is my drawback number one in case of barter system, that there is a double coincidence of wants. So I have written, you know, this person is a manufacturer of aircraft. This is Mr. A. This is a manufacturer of aircraft and he requires 1 liter of milk. So it is not necessary that milk vendor requires air top. So it is double coincidence of wants. It may not happen that both the persons have the same type of wants. So this is my drawback number one. It is due to that we have changed to money, and I will be telling you how we have entered into the money economy. Money is the medium of exchange. So second drawback is indivisible goods. The point is, when I say indivisible goods, you know, it becomes very difficult for the manufacturer of aircraft if he wants to buy clothing, he wants to buy gold, if he wants to buy anything, you know. And he in against of that, he wants to give, you know, aircraft. So he has to cut into the pieces. So how we can divide that goods into pieces? It is very difficult. So that was drawback number two, that in case of barter system, the indivisibility of goods was there. So because of these drawbacks, we have shifted from barter to money. Now money system is a better way of exchange. So you have written drawback number two, indivisible goods. Mr. A cannot cut aircraft into small pieces just to want to buy that anything. And the third drawback and the last drawback is perishable goods. Now what I mean by perishable? The goods which are being sold by this person, you know, if for example, I'm talking of a milk vendor. He is selling the milk. And supposedly the wife of milk vendor says to milk vendor that we want to have real estate. Now in case you want to buy real estate, that milk vendor wants to buy real estate and he wants to give milk in against of real estate. It cannot be possible that, because buying real estate will take some time, and within that time that milk will destroy. You know, that will not be of good quality. So perishable goods, barter system is not working. In case we want to divide it indivisible, that barter system was not working. And if double coincidence of wants is not there, then in that case also barter system is not working. So due to these drawbacks, we have entered into a new system. Automatically, I will tell you what are the stages in that, how from first stage to second stage to third stage, we have entered into that economy named as money economy. So now we are into what should be the qualities of that money. You know, we have told that, I have told you that money is a medium of exchange. That is okay. But what should be, what are the functions which this money perform? And what should be the qualities of this money? So firstly, I will be coming to the qualities. So please, I know, second point, desirable quality of money, because these are the drawbacks. First drawback is there is double confidence of wants. Second drawback is perishable goods. The third drawback is indivisibility. Now these three drawbacks should be converted into merits of money. Then only I will say these are the qualities of money. So please write on third point, desirable qualities of money. Desirable qualities of money. Desirable qualities of money. A point. It should be divisible. You know, if I want to purchase one cup of tea, you know, and I am giving 2000 currency note to that particular person, then he will be returning me the balance amount, you know. So I will say this money should have a quality of divisibility. So these are the basic qualities that money should have. First is divisibility, and second is ready acceptance. Now this INR, this Indian rupee note, 2000 currency note, which is being started after monetization of 2016 by the government of India. In that case, you know, it should be accepted. People should have trust in that. For example, in our country, the central bank is Reserve Bank of India, and this RBI has the sole authority to issue the currency note. So all people should have trust in RBI, and they are ready to accept that 2000 currency note. So these should be the qualities of money. The first is ready acceptability of that money. Second is it should be divisible. And the third is high value related to weight. I will be telling you that what I mean by high value related to weight. But before that, I again repeat the four qualities. The first is ready acceptance. Now, my dear friend, I will be showing you one site, Zimbabwe site, and that in that case I will be showing you how or which currency is being used by Zimbabwe. Now Zimbabwe is not using Zimbabwe dollars or rupee. Now they are using US dollars or GBP because of so many reasons. It was not accepted, you know, because of high rate of inflation. Zimbabwe country itself has closed that currency, and now they are running with USD. Just see, have a look on this, that what Zimbabwe dollar sign to distinguish it from other dollar denominated was official currency of Zimbabwe from, just see, 1982 12 April 2009. It means after 2009 they have stopped using that currency. It was subject to period of above inflation. Now how much inflation was there? It is increase in the In economics, inflation, we know that what is inflation, okay? Followed by a period of hyperinflation. When I say hyperinflation, when inflation is out of control, that is hyperinflation. We have already discussed in understanding business cycles. The Zimbabwe dollar was introduced in 1980 directly to replace this dollar, act as similar to this US dollar. Over time, hyperinflation in Zimbabwe reduced dollar to one of the lowest value currency units in the world. It means people are not ready to accept Zimbabwe currency. So that money should have a quality that all should be accepted. All people should accept that currency. That should be the quality which should be there. So the point is, which I want to tell you, that first is it should be readily acceptable. Supposedly now Zimbabwe again start with their own currency. Now, it may be possible people must be skeptical about that whether they should accept that currency, that Zimbabwe dollar or not. Because in the past, you know, that has, that there, due to hyperinflation, that value has been decreased to negligible value. So, first feature of a money which should have the best quality of money, it should be readily acceptable by people. Second is, it should be divisible. It means if I am giving 100 rupee currency note and I want to buy 20 rupees, 30 rupees of goods, then 70 rupees should be, you know, he should return me and I will accept it. It means that 100 currency note can be divisible, should be divisible. So that is my second quality. The third is high value related to weight. Now, what is the meaning of high value related to weight? Now, you must have seen, you know, coins which have been issued by government of India. And I want to show you that how these coins, you know, these are the coins. The rupee one coin is worth more than one rupee. Now, what is the meaning of this? Because I will be using this the site which I have for explaining you, the value of money is more than the worth of its weight. It means if there is a, you know, generally in the olden days, there used to be a copper element, copper metal, which is being used in this rupee, and nowadays they are using some part of silver in that rupee. But I am talking of copper. In the ancient days, that copper is costlier, and at one time the rates of copper, the huge increase was there. And what people were doing, the people started melting that coins because that copper worth is more than a rupee. You're getting a point. So the point is, just see this. Firstly, I will be reading this. A consumer has taken the old 1 rupee coin is worth substantially more than 1 rupee face value due to its metal content. What amuses me about the story is that it is in fact the truth that the coins are worth higher than their face value. But for more difficult reasons than those are floating around, I can see explanation for this. It means because of the content part, you know, the silver content and all that. Just see, in this nowadays, denominations, Indian rupee, just let me show you the coins. Frequently used 1 rupee, 2 rupee, 5 rupee and 10 rupee. Now 10 rupee coin, it has some content of silver. Just see. Now if mass 87 grams, value is this, 10 rupees, diameter is this, thickness is this, composition, aluminium and bronze. Now aluminium, copper is 92%, aluminium is 6% and nickel is 2%. Now supposedly in coming days, the value of copper due to some reason has increased like anything. Now what people will start doing it, they will be start melting that 10 rupee coin, and out of that they will be getting copper, and they will be getting copper, and that copper will be sold somewhere else. Yeah. And that has more value as compared to 10 rupee coin. So by that I mean that high value related to weight. It means Indian rupee, the value should be more as compared to weight, because otherwise people will start melting it. You know. So this should be the quality, that the value of 10 rupees should be more than the value of that copper which is included in that. And the last is difficulty to counterfeit. It means it cannot be printed by any bank. It should only be printed by the central bank of that country. For example, in India, the Reserve Bank of India is my central bank. So it should be only issued by that and not by other shadow banks. As in case, you know, Pakistan, generally they print fake currency notes, Indian fake currency notes. So that cannot be possible. So these are the four features of, I will say, best qualities of a coin, of a money. They should have ready acceptability, they should be divisible. Second, third point, they should have a high value related to their weight and difficulty to counterfeit. So now I am coming to the functions of money. So I have written one point, you know, note one, in order to explain. Difficulty to counterfeit. When INR is printed only by RBI, central bank, and not by shadow banks in surrounding countries, because as I have just told you, in case of Pakistan. So I am coming to the last point of today's lecture number two, that what are the functions of money and how money has been firstly evolved. So money, first function is, we have just seen, it is a medium of exchange. Second function is, it is a store of value, and third is a unit of account. So please firstly write down, then I will be explaining each and every function. Functions of money. So in this learning outcome, we have discussed what is the function of money. Up to this date, I have just given you the background, what is the meaning of barter system, what were the drawbacks, what should be the qualities of a money, and now I am coming to the main point. Now those backgrounds, you know, that will help you in understanding the concepts. So this is function of money. The first function is, it should have a medium of exchange. The second function is, it should be a store of value. And the third is a unit of account. So these are the three functions. Case study about origin of money. No doubt it is not in your course, but because I want to tell you, it will clear your concepts of how money has been started. Earlier there used to be barter system, and when I say barter system, there used to be the the different drawbacks, different difficulties were there. So I have written first point, they are doing the barter system, but they have a difficulty of storing it, you know. They cannot store that. Now their people were wondering that they want to store the value. So they were purchasing gold or they were purchasing livestock. Just see in this arrow, people started saving value in livestock or in precious metal. And when I say precious metal, I talk of gold. People were going to the goldsmith. They were buying gold because their value can be stored in that. Now again, there comes a problem that, you know, if you have bought 1 kg of gold and that is to be exchanged, you know, with some goods, and only 250 grams of gold will be utilized. In that case, you have to break that gold into 4 parts, and 1 part is to be given for that. So now, after some time period, that goldsmith stopped breaking that gold, rather issuing a note named as a promissory note that I have received 1 kg of gold from this person, and any one person who is a holder of this can take that 1 kg of gold from me. So that was considered, that was the origin of the money, the paper money and promissory note. So from goldsmith, because all the people, they have trust in that goldsmith. So the trust factor is important. So just see, I have just shown you the different charts, you know, the different flow chart, how the things have happened. Firstly, barter economy, difficulty of storing in the barter economy. Then people started saving value in livestock. Then goldsmith. Then goldsmith is used as receipt. This person has taken this. And then first currency in the form of promissory note created by goldsmith. And then paper currency came into picture. Then paper currency, because it is the goldsmith has started issuing promissory notes, and from there paper currency came into picture. And now see that governor writes down in that, I promise to pay to the bearer of this amount of this, in case you have a currency note in your pocket, please take it out and please read that I promise to pay the bearer of this value of this. Now the point is, you should have a trust in that, you know. If we don't have trust in that the issuer bank, then it will not be workable. So like this, I have told you that how people have started doing the work and how that money has been started. Now the last point, definitions of money. Now money, you know, we have discussed what are the functions of money. Now when I say functions of money, again I start with the 3 points. Store of value. Money has a store of value. Money should be a medium of exchange. These are the functions. Money acts as a medium of exchange. Money acts as a store of value. Money acts as a note of account. So unit of account. So these are the different functions. And now I am on to what are the definitions of money. I will be telling you 2 definitions. One is near money, and second is broad money, narrow money and broad money. When I say narrow, as the name indicates, narrow. Broad, as the name indicates, broad. It means broad includes narrow also. So firstly, we will discuss what is narrow. Narrow money is the amount of notes or currencies and coins in circulation in the economy. It means the how much notes and coins are being issued by RBI or the central bank of that country. That is named as narrow money. It along with the amount deposited in the bank deposit, saving account, current accounts. I repeat. The money which is being circulated by a central bank of that country, coins, rupees, currency notes, along with the bank deposit, that is narrow money. But what is broad money? Broad money is narrow money plus. Broad money is narrow money plus amount available in liquid assets. As in cash flow statement, we did cash and cash equivalent. When I say cash equivalent, it means temporary investments. It means those which can be converted into cash. Those are named as liquid assets. So, I repeat, narrow money is the total amount of currency, notes, which is being issued by central bank for circulation in the economy, plus the amount deposited in the bank deposits. Broad money is narrow money plus the amount available in liquid assets. It is not hard cash. Rather, it has been invested, so that is liquid assets. So if I add them, I will say it is named as broad money. So I think in this lecture number 2, I have discussed how this money has been origin. What is a barter system? What are the drawbacks of barter system? What should be the features of a money? And what are the functions of the money? Hope you have enjoyed it. Be happy, be jolly, be cheerful.